It's a great pleasure to have a chance to talk to Andre Singer, who I've known for some years. Andre, when and where were you born?
I was born in London.
Mm-hmm.
I was born on the auspicious day that World War II was declared ending, on the 4th of May, 1945, in Edgware. That's just outside London.
Excellent. Well, you brought good tidings with you, but...
Well, it was always claimed that Churchill announced the end of the war 4 days later as a result of my birth, but I think I can't really claim that as...
Tell me something about your ancestry, as far back as you like to go. I mean, people sometimes go back to their grandparents anyway. Can you tell me something about
that? I'm a peculiar combination of family, in as far as my mother, and my name Singer comes from my mother's side of the family. My parents were never married, so my father took my mother's name.
Mm.
My mother was a Romanian Jew, born in and grew up in Chernivitz, which is currently part of the Ukraine, but when she was a girl was Romania. And from a professional family in Chernivitz, where her father was a mathematics professor in the local college and a school and college, and my mother and her brother went to school there, grew up there, and she then went to study in Vienna, and this was now in the early 1930s, and as a result of what was happening in Germany at the time and the pressures that came about, her family decided it was better for her to come, not to go back to Chernivitz, where things were beginning to be tense already while she was a student, but to come to London. So in the late 30s, she came to London to stay with a cousin, and then war broke out and cut off, and she didn't see her family again after that. My father is German, was German. He was from a Catholic family in Germany, in northwest Germany, in a small town called... No, I've forgotten the name of his town, but it's northwest Germany.
Yeah.
And he was a communist. He was a journalist, an intellectual in Germany, and quite senior in the Marx Engels Institute in Berlin before the war. And he was a publisher of the communist newspaper from Berlin to distribute around Germany. And clearly was quite knowledgeable and knew people in the hierarchy as a result of his journalistic background and his position in the Communist Party. So in 1933 he was imprisoned when the Nazis came to power. And because he was senior enough, he had enough contacts. He was in prison for about a year. He was then sprung from prison by his friends, who were still powerful enough to do that, and he fled to Prague. So in 34, 35, 36, he did the same job as Berlin in Prague, running a newspaper for the Communist Party out of Prague. And then when the Nazis moved into Czechoslovakia, he fled there, and he came to London. So a lot of his some went to Moscow, some went to London, some went elsewhere, but quite a few came to London. From here on in, information about him is rather complicated because he would never talk about it. But from friends and various other newspaper articles I've put together, basically he was a spy for the British during the war. And the only reason one can surmise that when he died in his obituary, this was said that he worked for the British government, and he was one of the few Germans in London who could travel backwards and forwards, and he went to Lisbon and he went to various other places outside London for the whole period of the war. And this was, most of the Germans were interned, and he was clearly working during that period. And he then met my mother in London, and my two sisters and I are the result of that liaison. They lived together but never married, and they parted on less than amicable terms, really, when I was a teenager, a young teenager. So I was a friend of my father, but never a son to my father, if you understand that, the subtlety of that difference.
Mm. What sort of person was he?
He was somebody one would never recommend as a father figure, but he was an engaging and extremely personable and somewhat eccentric man. He died in 1976 as a result of a car accident in Soho, and at that time he was well enough known to have a Times obituary where he was called Soho's last boulevardier has died. And he was known as that because his circle of friends were the Soho set. So Francis Bacon, the Robert Colquhoun, Robert McBride, the painters, writers, poets of that ilk who virtually frequented. So he lived in Soho. My father had an apartment there. And he spent, I would say, an inordinate amount of time in the pubs of Soho. And my youth, when I went to see him, was partly having to give him some of my university grant so he could keep himself in drink, but partly being taken around to things that, in hindsight, I really wish I had realized the significance of. But at that time, it was just, I slightly cringed at some of the things. The Colony Club, a famous club in Soho, he was there a lot, where Francis Bacon was. So I saw all these characters in my late teenage, early 20 days. But I was told they were famous painters and all, but I didn't know them. I didn't know, and I knew them there, but I didn't know their significance until later, of course, and then it was too late. So he was an extremely engaging. I would call him a kind of a friend, but he was a somewhat eccentric man.
Yeah. What about your mother? What was her character?
My mother was somebody who, I have to say, probably did not deserve the hardship she went through as a result of having three children. She was a young, impressionable, rather spoilt from her background. She was a sort of the princess of the family in Romania. In London, she had nobody really, one or two friends who tried to help her and a distant cousin that she was staying with. And it was a very, very hard time for her. And it continued to be difficult. She had to work. She cleaned, she secretarial work, she did anything she could. And she could never break out of that particular bubble. And as a result, and the thing where it obviously affects us as children, was that most of my childhood up till about the age of 11 were in homes, because she couldn't afford to sustain us as a family.
And when you say homes, you mean children's
homes? Children's homes, yeah. Mm. Different children's homes. Mm. And she struggled to earn enough and put enough together to have a flat in Kilburn by the time I was 11, and then I came, and with my sisters we then had a family, three of us and my mother. Mm. And from then on we stayed together in Kilburn till later. Mm. So she had a difficult time.
Yes. When did she die?
She died in 2001.
Right. So. When you were in these homes, were you also going to school? Or?
Yes. I was. The longest one was a sort of an educational home in Reading, which was for about 4 years. And I went to a junior school in Reading, I think called the Battle School. And the others were much shorter periods before, where I didn't go if I did go to school, it's been washed from my memory. I don't remember the schooling there. I remember the homes, but not the schooling. Mm. I think there was schooling within the homes when I was much younger then.
I mean, do you remember the homes with horror, or...?
I do, actually. Certainly the last one.
Mm.
On the one hand, it had the advantage of being a home where my sisters were there as well, and they were older than me, and that was good, because I had the sort of protection, if you like, of both of my sisters. But it was a very disciplinarian place, and I have, unfortunately, I met some nice people there, contemporaries, and one or two of whom I still know, sort of 50 years later. But the home itself, I don't have any affection for whatsoever.
You don't go back to reunions there.
Well, it was we are talking about a different time, I think, when discipline was regarded differently. I mean, things that happened there with children are things that probably today would be regarded as not abuse so much as, but excessively harsh in how children should behave and so on. Then I think it was seen as normal. It's, you know, you wet your bed, you have to stand by your bed with a sheet over your head, that kind of things, which are not physically physical punishment, but they are demeaning, and they are things that you would not, or I would hope in today's age, you would not inflict on a child of, you know, 8, 9, 10, 11 years old. So
Do you remember any hobbies or interests you had up to about the age of 11?
No, I was not a child who, you know, wanted to collect stamps or follow trains or I was brought up with a certain liking for music. Not that I was musical, but I liked music, and I think that's something that stayed with me my whole life. So the liking of an understanding of, to some extent, of opera and ballet and so on, I think that came from already a very early age. But other than that, I certainly had nothing that made me feel that one day I might become an anthropologist. That was a very late in life movement. So I have no specific hobbies or memories of childhood obsessions at that stage at all.
I mean, one thing that might lead you to be an anthropologist, which is being an outsider, was your Jewish background. Now, you said your mother was Jewish. Did she take you, were you bar mitzvahed or anything?
No, not at all. It was actually, I don't know, I think circumstance had a lot to play with it. My mother, like my father, was, I think, liked to think of herself as communist. I don't think my mother's political knowledge or understanding was very profound. I think it was more of an emotional thing. And that's, I think, what attracted her at that time. Both my parents were a-religious. My mother had an emotional attachment to Judaism, very much so, in as far as, I think, both her parents were not Orthodox, but they were practicing Jews. She wasn't. Her brother, who she was very close to, who was younger than her, went to Israel, so she had connections with Israel. Up until the school, the final home that I was in was a Jewish home, and to that extent, they, to be quite honest, I don't even remember going to synagogue, even there. But the two ladies who ran it advertised the fact that we were a Jewish home, but this was pre bar mitzvah age in any case. I never learnt Hebrew. I never went to a Jewish school. It was a local primary school. And when I left and we went back to my mother, I had no Jewish association, really. I mean, I was neither seen as, at school, for example, I was neither seen as Jewish or not Jewish. Mm. It never sort of came up in the Willesden that I grew up in at that time. And I didn't regard myself, I never had a religious affiliation as a child, and was never encouraged to. And it was only later I started questioning it and answering to it. So it's been a sort of an a-religious background as a child, and certainly no bar mitzvah or anything.
No rituals, no household rituals.
None at all. We had a family friend that occasionally on festive days we would go and join them. Mm. So I kind of a little bit knew what it was about, the Passover or an occasional Friday dinner we would be taken to. But it was, I think my mother was very ambivalent about that, the whole Jewishness. And I think she saw a split between cultural Judaism and religious Judaism, and never wanted the religious side to be anything to be imposed upon us. And the cultural side, she didn't have much opportunity to push it in our direction. So it was kind of left as an unspoken part of our past.
So later on, you said you got interested in these questions. I mean, what was your religious trajectory after 11, 12?
Well, I never really had one. I became more interested in it and more intellectual when I was recently making a film about the concentration camps than I had in my whole life up to that point. And again, I always found that, I mean, I regard myself as, I think I'm, I regard myself really as an atheist, a kind of, with a tinge of agnosticism there, but basically as an atheist. I've never had any religious affiliation. Mm. Part of my youth was being brought up with friends who were Russian Orthodox, so I went to the Russian Orthodox Church every week as a later in my life, when I was a young man. But that was a sort of a social activity and a cultural activity, but I never had any religious affiliation. Mm. I was friends with the Russian Orthodox Archbishop at that time, Archbishop Bloom, for many years. But I never regarded myself as a Russian Orthodox or a Christian. So in religious terms, it didn't play a part in my life. Cultural terms, I didn't. Neither did it really. I mean, if somebody said to me, "Are you Jewish?" I would always hesitate. Mm. You know, it's not something I would say, "Yes, I'm Jewish." I always acknowledged then that I was Jewish, but that it was a cultural thing because if your mother's Jewish, you're Jewish. But I didn't feel like I was a member of a Jewish group or a fraternity or anything like that. So it's a rather ambivalent sort of relationship.
You were never confirmed into the Church of England or baptized?
No, not at all.
What about the communist streak in both your parents, really? I mean, this is anticipating later on, but did this lead you towards the left?
I think so, yes. I think I was, and later on I did. I was a young socialist in my late school time and early university and so on. But I don't know if that was something that was, I think it was more sort of social consciousness rather than upbringing. Because neither my mother nor my father, and of course the period they were together was only really, when I was growing up, was only 3 years, from 11 to 14 they were together in Kilburn, in the flat that I was there for those years. So I suppose they're quite impressionable years, but that was, I perceived that period as one of sort of antagonism between my parents, and they never really talked politics to us as children, or to me certainly. So I don't think that was something I gleaned because of my parentage. I think it was probably a natural phenomenon of my schooling and general ambience in that period of time in Wills and that early 60s.
When you went to the flat at 11, did you went to another school, obviously.
Yes.
What school did you go to?
I came from Reading at that yeah. time when I was 11. I came and I was then at a school called Salisbury Road School in Willesden. And I was in their junior school from 11 to... I was there for 1 year in the primary bit, then had to take the 11 plus. Mm. And then from that, I moved from Salisbury Road to Willesden County as a... It was then a grammar school in Willesden.
What was that like?
I had a wonderfully anarchic school time there, really. I mean, I was not a great pupil. I was. It was a co-educational, pretty rough school at that time, surrounded by even rougher secondary modern schools. So there was a lot of friction, street ganging, that kind of thing at that period of time. I went there in 1963, and I enjoyed it. Actually, I had an older sister at the school who was an exemplary student.
Mm.
Got all her exams. She was top of class and on monitor, and she was 3 years above me at school. And I was regarded as a bit of a not uncontrollable, but I was not like her. I was not an exemplary scholar. I played truant and I had it. I was with a gang of friends, and scholarship was not my main ambition at that time. It was basically more having a good time. And I think it was the first period of freedom, if you like, from having left the constraints of Reading and back in London and having no real constraints at family. So I think I was a pretty unruly kid. Yeah. I got into a lot of trouble at that time.
And you were a day boy, obviously.
Yes, day boy, yeah.
Were there particular things you were interested in at school, sport or...?
No, I was hopeless at sport. The things I did relatively well at school were chess. I was in the school team at chess. I think in terms of sort of pastime or in terms of trajectory, no. I mean, I enjoyed the arts side of schooling more than I did science. My sister was very good at science, I was not. I found quite rapidly I didn't have a very mathematical mind. I found that difficult. I had to retake maths exams during my whole life, really. but I enjoyed the art side of it. I was not a great linguist, but I quite enjoyed French and those schoolings there. But nothing that one would say, you know, I got one or two little prizes for different things, but nothing that stood me out in school above the others.
Were there any teachers who you remember as being influential or you liked?
Well, it's one of those curious things in life that a few years ago got in touch with a small group of school friends. One of them was very enterprising, and because of our new media, wanted to get in touch. And so four or five of us get together once a year and sort of think about going back and talking about school. And I find one of them astonishes me because he remembers the teachers, he remembers what people said, he remembers things in the corridors and the class. I remember none of that. I had a terrible I remember certain specific things, but I don't have that kind of memory. And I sit with my mouth open when he says, well, do you remember in 1964 we went on this field trip and so-and-so said this and so-and-so did that and this teacher did that, and I have no recollection of it whatsoever. So it's quite hard. I mean, I have, you know, there were one or two teachers. I remember the teachers. I remember their names, and I visualize them. But I had no very strong rapport with anybody that I bring back to. I think people are very different about their schooling and what they remember about it.
Yes. Any other kind of extra curricular activities? You weren't in any debating societies, political clubs.
My extracurricular side really was taken up by what I mentioned earlier about this social link to the Russian Orthodox, because it came about because my mother was a friend of one of her close friends was Russian Orthodox, and they had sons about my age. And so they had a camp in Wales every summer, and where these boys went, and a lot of Russian Orthodox young, mainly male as it happened, from England, and French Russian Orthodox girls from Paris, and they would all get together and have this camp in Wales, which was run by the Russian Orthodox Archbishop. And they were wonderful people, and I had very close friends there, and it became my social outlet other than school. So from about the age of 14, 15 upwards till my early 20s, I went to that camp every summer. And I think this was something that, because my mother couldn't afford holidays, this was a holiday venue for people who couldn't really afford it. So for me, it was terrific escapism, and so all my holidays were there with this group. And every weekend we would get together in the house of one of the Russian Orthodox family called Behr, BHR, and it was a fantastic shambolic house in South London, and they would play guitar. I mean, I was in awe of them because they all were multilingual and could all play instruments and so on. I could do none of that. So I kind of felt myself as sort of slightly on the outside, but loved being part of it. And that sort of became an alternative family, that whole group. And the Archbishop became a kind of alternative father figure kind of there. And I was very close to that group for many years. And that was, if you like, my schooling hobby, because it was my weekends and it was my holidays, and so I was school during the week and that was my weekends.
You didn't have any visual hobbies, that's to say photography or going to films?
No.
Film watching or anything?
No, I hardly went. In my unruly youth, all I remember is that a friend of mine from school and I would sneak up the back of the State Cinema in Kilburn, and in the air vent area you could climb in and watch movies through the grill without paying, because we didn't have the money to pay. So we would sneak off and go to the movies that way. So that was my first viewing of films. But it was more the illicit thrill, I think, of doing wrong than the films themselves that we went for. So that went on until they caught us, and then they locked the entrance to that.
You don't sound as if you were studying incredibly hard, but so what happened? What happened at the end of schooling?
Well, I sort of lurched through school, if you like. I managed to just about keep up. I got a reasonable O-level, A-level tally, but nothing astonishing, and nothing that would have automatically got me into university. And from Wilson County at that time, not many went to university. It was kind of one of those schools which wasn't a beacon for stepping into higher education. But I did come, I suppose, from a background and a family expectation that university would be wonderful if you could go to university. And my I had various sort of family friends who encouraged that if one could go to university, you should. So I had no career thoughts at that time. And I applied to various universities in the old system and initially didn't get in because my grades weren't high enough to automatically be accepted. And I was told I had to retake some of my A-levels to get higher grades to go. So I decided at that time that I would teach. And I got a job in a primary school as a teacher. And I started that while in the evenings deciding I would retake my A-levels. So I started doing Russian because of my Russian connections and retaking a couple of other subjects at a local polytechnic at that time, Kilburn Polytechnic, no longer existing. And within a couple of weeks of starting teaching, which I sort of faced with some trepidation, having to control kids and my first job. I'd done a lot of holiday jobs, but they were more sort of manual and working in a factory and a delivery service and delivering newspapers, that kind of job. But this was my first proper job, paid job. And I found it somewhat intimidating. And I was visiting I had a family friend, a man called Donald Douglas, who invited me to go to the home of an archaeologist near Oxford, where they were having a sort of a family weekend. And I went, and while there, they opened a newspaper, and there was an advert. I think a lot of my life has been like this, happens chance, things that happen without any planning. There's a newspaper, and in there was an advert for a new college that was opening up near Oxford, in a place called Farringdon, near Farringdon, called Buckland, University Hall Buckland. And this was an experimental college that would be taught by Oxford teachers, but doing a London degree. And they were looking for students to help start this college. And we were close, this house of the archaeologist was quite close to this. So we said, well, let's go and have a look. So we drove there, and the college had already started. And I then went to and met the warden of the college, who said, do you play cricket? And I sort of said, well, I have done. He said, okay, that's fine. Now, what do you want to study? And so I was offered a place, and I thought, well, I carry on teaching and do my A-levels and go somewhere else, but this sounds quite exciting and quite interesting. There were only going to be 60 people in the first year, 30 male, 30 female in this college, in a beautiful house in a village outside Oxford. And so I gave up my job and went and got a grant. And went there, and that was the beginning of my university life.
What did you study there?
I did economics with one of the papers in the London economics degree being anthropology. So that was my first knowledge of.
Raymond Firth, no doubt, was figuring then.
Sorry?
Raymond Firth was no doubt figuring in the.
No. Funnily, it was certainly in the curriculum, absolutely. Yeah. My tutor. And this started my whole anthropology sort of background. Well, my tutor at that time was Malcolm MacLeod, who's now retired and ended up in Glasgow. And my tutorials and my teaching was Oxford system, even though it was a London degree. And so I had my tutorials in the Institute of Anthropology in Oxford. So it was almost as though I was, even though Oxford at that time didn't do undergraduate anthropology, it was my first part learning about anthropology properly.
What year was this? About 66?
I went 63 I started, and 66 I graduated.
63 to 66. Yeah. Oh, well, we overlapped in Oxford then. And I knew Malcolm then, but anyway, we'll come back.
He was the graduate assistant at Oxford then.
Yeah.
And I think he had just come back from doing field work in Ghana back then.
And you enjoyed the anthropology, or?
Oh, I loved it. I had great fun. I mean, I found myself having to catch up, if you like, in terms of studying and so on. I never regarded myself, and never have done, as a great scholar. Mm. I think probably because I never worked hard enough at it. Mm. But it was the first time I didn't like economics very much. Mm. But it was the first time that I got to that position of finding a subject that I enjoyed, and followed it through from then on.
Yeah. Well, let's have a break then, because this is the end of your Buckland experience, and we'll have some lunch and continue afterwards.
Absolutely.
So, when you had finished at the college near Farringdon, what did you do then?
I think I was, as with a lot of my life, in a state of indecision about what to do. Because, again, reflecting on your question about hobbies and so on, I found I didn't have a position in life that I knew I wanted to be. I had no idea what my career would be. I didn't feel at that point I was going to go into an academic career. I didn't really. I had done a lot of holiday teaching to sustain myself over the years. I didn't really feel that I was going to make a great teacher. I mean, I was interested in it, but I didn't think that was, and I did not know what I was going to do. But by, again, one of these happenstance things, one of my great long-standing friends in life studied with me at this college, Buckland, and he was in literature at that time. This is Brian Street.
Oh, yes.
And we were contemporaries all the way through, and we were both discussing where we're going to go to next. And because we knew Oxford quite well by that time, having spent 3 years on the outskirts and going in and out, thought it would be quite nice to go and do something in Oxford. And I, at that time, having had sort of advice and tuition from both Malcolm McLeod and then a chap called Mike Heppel, who went off to Australia, and having got to know Evans Pritchard and the Leonhards and so on, that era, it was suggested that why didn't I at least do the diploma in anthropology, which was their transition course, to see if anthropology was going to be your career path. Brian, meanwhile, had become friendly with Godfrey Leonhardt because of Leonhardt's association with Leavis here in Cambridge and his love for literature, and thought that it would be a good thing for Brian Street to do the same thing. So, nothing venture, nothing gain. We both applied and did the diploma in anthropology at Oxford. I think with neither of us thinking, eureka, we're going to become anthropologists or whatever. And then at the end of that first year, which I enjoyed very much, the person who actually accepted that year, who was the acceptance tutor for the diploma, was also the external examiner for London on our degree courses in anthropology. It was Rodney Needham. So it all came together, and it was rather good, and he was very encouraging as well. So we did the diploma that year, and at the end of the diploma year, the same kind of thing, where to next?
Yeah.
But what happened was that the university expedition of that year, the end of that year, was going to Iran, and wanted anthropologists to join a team of medical students who were studying ticks and various other phenomena and illnesses and so on in Western Iran. But they needed to finalize their grants. They needed anthropology as part of the expedition because it's meant to be enhancing their relationship with the local people and the tribal people they were going with. So both Brian and I became the anthropologists on that expedition, which goes down in history as the only, perhaps it's been overtaken recently, I have no idea, but at that stage the only Oxford University expedition that went into bankruptcy. we were absolutely hopeless at organising. But we went to the Western Iran. We motored around and set up camp with the Basri in southwest Iran, which was made famous about that time by Frederick Bath, who had written about them. And we wrote reports, and we had a very interesting time at a time when there weren't quite the tensions. It was still quite difficult among tribal Iran, but the tensions were very different to today. And came back, having done our first, if you like, mini field work. So when it came to the next step, we both in our different ways thought we would stay on and do more anthropology. So I applied to do the B.Lit at Oxford, being supervised initially by Evans Pritchard and then by Peter Leonhardt later. And Brian went straight into a DPhil course doing literature and produced a book at the end of that for his thesis on called The Savage in Literature. So I then worked on tribal peoples of Iran for a B.Lit, a thesis, 2-year course, and finished the B.Lit, and then was suggested I stayed on to do a DPhil, so that I'm becoming a perennial student. But doing the DPhil, of course, one's talking about proper field work, and at that stage, although I was in an Africanist department where John Beattie and Godfrey and Tina Fontaine for a while and Mary Douglas in and out and so on, very African orientated, the only part of the world I really knew anything about, and even that rather minimally, was Iran. So I decided that I would do field work in Iran. And so I did that, I carried on. I went, I was going to study in Western Iran, following in the footsteps of Frederick Bath, but there had been a Bakhtiari revolt at that time. And the government were very tense and nervous about field work in the West. So I had a fellowship at that time for the British Institute of Persian Studies. So I was doing language in Tehran while trying to get my local visas. And I shifted my attention to the East, and where things were slightly more settled. So I ended up doing field work on the Iran-Afghan border about sedentarization and Afghan nomads in Iran and relationships between them and local farmers and so on. I studied in a small semi-nomadic village in eastern Iran. I spent nearly 2 years off and on doing that for my sins.
Who was your supervisor?
Again, initially it was EP, because I had been his research assistant for a couple of years in my B.Lit year. So I was working on his Zandi material at that time. But he was getting increasingly frail, and I tended to have a role of his sort of, when I was in Oxford, as his kind of minder rather than more his student. And Peter Leonhardt was then expert in Iran, And so he took over and became my supervisor. And then Eric Sunderland became my examiner after that. So I did that.
Tell me something about DP.
About DP?
Yes. Like, I mean,
he was... AP was wonderful. I became a kind of surrogate son to EP. I mean, it was a sort of both a privilege and to some extent quite difficult, because I did spend quite a lot of time sort of... it's very hard to be patronising about a great man like EP, but I became a sort of a keeper because... this was towards the end of his life. He retired, I think, in 19... let me think. I did my field work in 70 and 71, and I worked for him in the 2 years before that. And I think he'd just retired. And he has a very large family.
Yeah.
But he was kind of embattled with his family. So he has two sons who are about my age, and a younger son, and a younger daughter, and an older daughter, Shanine. And the older daughter had left. He and the sons were not having a good relationship at that time, and the younger ones were still at school, and therefore not really able to keep the household. So in the end, I moved into the house. And
Jack Straw's Lane.
Sorry?
Jack Straw's Lane?
2 years, no, because this was just before I did field work. And I went off and did field work. So it was about 3-4 years before he died. And so I lived in the Ark, as it was called, there with the family. And it was a fascinating time. So I spent a lot of time with him. I drove him around, and when he got his honorary doctorate at Manchester, I think I was there as the figure to make... He had diabetes and was not supposed to drink, and yet he liked the odd drink, and so I was there to try and keep that in moderation and generally look after him. So it was, as I say, it was both an honour, but also quite difficult.
Many people regard him as the greatest British anthropologist of the 20th century. What do you think contributed to that?
I think it has to be... it really has to be on the work. The Nuer and the Zandi fieldwork and results of the fieldwork certainly dominated all of our anthropological education and background, and I suppose in a way revolutionised what anthropologists were doing at that time. I think he was never seen as the great teacher as such. It was very much, I think, based on his... on those tones. I mean, I worked for a couple of years on the Zandi material, resulting in a publication about Zandi men and women. But this was much post the impact that it already had. I think from the work in the 30s and 40s. I think he. It's hard as to... it's a hard question. I'm not sure, as an anthropologist, what one can answer is why somebody was propelled above. I remember vividly some kind of celebratory ASA in Oxford at that time, in the end of the 60s, or it might have been early 70s, it might have been about 1972, 73, and... EP was quite frail, but sitting in an armchair in the garden of the Institute, and it was kind of the divine king concert. The great anthropologists from all universities came and sort of paid obeisance to EP in the corner of the garden. It's a wonderful scene. A complete sort of image of that particular scene. So I think by his peers he was regarded as the greatest. I think that's a who can tell who they are, but he was certainly great.
So it was a
very important part of my life, that little period. And I went off to do fieldwork, so then I had to give that up. I came back to write up my thesis and so on, but by this stage, we had another assistant. I was living separately and just got engaged to get married, and so life went on differently. And in fact, I was away when he died, sadly. I was on my first film trip. When I was written to that he had died back at the Ark that year.
So you mentioned the first film trip. Did you go into that straight after your...
No, it was...
What happened after your PhD?
When I came back, I feel I'm sort of giving you a mantra of a life of indecision. But I came back, had finished my field work, I was going to write up. I started applying for one or two university jobs, slightly worried about whether I was going to fit a university mold. I wasn't sure it was going to be the life for me. And while I was starting to write up my thesis, I saw an advert in the New Statesman for a film company looking for anthropologists to advise on films. And this was Granada Television starting up the Disappearing World series. I discussed this at Oxford, and it was kind of seen as slightly heretical, you know, television, film at that time. Not quite. This was 1973. It wasn't seen, and people actually didn't know anything about it either. You know, film at that time was, you watched Nanook in the Film Society in the evening, but that was really where film fitted anthropology. It wasn't really seen seriously. And Oxford was a relatively conservative department of anthropology, and so for one of their own to be going into film was, you know, E.P. and Godfrey and people didn't really know what to make of it. But I applied, and I was given the job at the same time, two of us at the same time, Melissa Llewellyn Davis and I, were the two anthropologists. There was a third called Angela Burr. Three of us were given jobs that year. In 73, and it was kind of that eureka moment, really. I knew nothing about film. I'm always asked, did I always want to be a filmmaker? And I had never had aspirations to go into film until I started that job at Granada Television. I left Oxford. I hadn't finished my thesis at that time. I went back and finished it a little later. And I worked for a very happy 10 years in Granada Television in film, with, first of all, with Brian Moser, who was heading that series. And later I took over from him and ran it myself when he left Granada. Alongside Melissa, Lerna Davis, Chris Curling, and Brian, and so we had a very fruitful and good 10 years.
Well, it was a very famous series and set of events. Why was it so conspicuously successful, do you think, and what were its characteristics?
The timing was perfect for us because, well, first of all, we were fortunate in having a very forward-looking, experimental and interesting head of television at that time, Sir Dennis Foreman, who did Brideshead Revisited and other great film things. He was an extraordinary man. And Dennis saw the potential for allowing Brian and the rest of us to create a niche, if you like, on television, or something that he personally saw as important, the disappearance of, I mean, I think it's a misnomer as it turned out to be, but at that time, the disappearance, cultural disappearance of different peoples around the world. And Brian, as a geologist, had come back from South America and had more of a current affairs approach to it than the rest of us. But that was its motif at the beginning. There were threats, whether it was Rhodes or missionaries or whatever, societies were going to be implode in some way or another, and here we have a chance to find out about it on film and show it to the public. And these films were not made for anthropologists, they were made for the public, but I think they had the prescience to have anthropologists both on board and to never make a film without an anthropologist in the field as part of the process. Television at that time, four channels only. So you had big viewing figures wherever you went on television there. So whereas you're lucky to get a million people watching a program today, then we regularly had 10 million watching a film, which was extraordinary. And in the factual side of television, it was dominated by programs like Survival had a major animal series that came out of Anglia Television. But nobody was tackling anthropology. And I think Dennis saw that if we cornered that market at Granada, then we let natural history in one independent channel and we would do anthropology. The BBC did a bit of everything. So whereas the BBC did a little of everything and had two channels, BBC One and BBC Two, ITV just had the one channel. And so they basically had different of the ITV stations choosing areas that they could specialize in, and they tended not to overlap. So Granada became the people to do current affairs with World in Action and anthropology with Disappearing World. And it they were shown at peak times, huge audiences, and all successful for several years. It was it's a phenomenon, really, because it's never successively and never been able to do that. And the BBC, although the BBC made some very good anthropological films or films with anthropological content, they were part of a mishmash. So they, you know, they had a series World About Us, and one week it would be climbing mountains, and another week it would be an anthropological film, and so on. So you never had a consistency. So they never had quite the same success as Disappearing World.
If you had to choose one of those films which you enjoyed making most or thought was most interesting and important, which one would you choose?
It's very difficult question to answer that, because different films had different resonances for me. And if we're talking about films I actually made as a director, because I researched lots of films first and then I became a director. And as a director, the one I am most, I suppose, attached to because of historical reasons and because I always wanted to do it, is the film I made on EP's work on the Azandi, so a film on witchcraft among the Azandi. And because that kind of squared the circle, if you like, it's where I came out of, and I was able to tackle it in difficult circumstances. More in Zaire than in the Sudan, but still answering some of those questions on film that EP had been asking in books. So I'm attached to that. The film that I think was more challenging, and I think I watch today with interest, even though it's very out of date, is the film I made in China on the Kazakhs, because it was made in 82. It was the first time Western crew were allowed to film tribal people in China, and it was a fascinating look at how a traditional Kazakh nomadic group had adapted to an enforced commune system in the Chen Shan Mountains in northwest of Urumqi, at a time where they wanted to continue. This was the constraints on the tribal people in China were much harsher in the 80s than they've subsequently become. And at that time, the Kazakhs tried to maintain their traditions under a system that didn't really want them to. Mm. So they changed their costumes to adapt. And the Khan of the group that we made the film amongst called himself the secretary of the commune. But in effect, it was a fascinating look at how people actually did maintain their own beliefs in a system that they really paid lip service to. And so I enjoyed the kind of complexity of trying to get that across to an audience.
Mm. Why do you think the Disappearing World series ended? Or
well, it's not what I think, it's what I know. It ran into some... When I was running it after Brian had left, we were still making very successful films. Competition was much greater at that time in terms of television. More channels were coming up and so on. And the problems in all of the broadcasters at that time were running up against various union difficulties. And on the final three films that I commissioned, one of which I made, which was the Kazakh film, and the other two films were made on a commune by Leslie Woodhead called Living with the Revolution, also in China. I was going to make another film in Yunnan at that time, and getting access and permissions in China was incredibly difficult. And we had managed to get permission, but we had to take a very limited crew. And there was a dispute at that time in the union about taking PAs, production assistants, along on a trip. And we didn't have, A, the budget, secondly, the need, because there was no role for a PA. There's no language that they could participate in. And we didn't have the permissions from the Chinese. And the union insisted that we had to take a PA. And it became a union battle inside Granada that the then controller, or the managing director of Granada, who was David Plowright, took a combative position on it and said, I'm not having guns on my lawn. We're not going to do this. We're going to end the series. I will withdraw the money for the series. So we were allowed to make the two films, which Leslie made his into 2 1-hours, but it was really two films. The third one was dropped, and the series was then dropped at that time because of that dispute. So after I'd finished, I then was going to do various other World in Action films or something else. But I decided that I wasn't going to move on to other genres. I wanted to do more anthropology. And I was offered the chance to make this series for the independent sector called Strangers Abroad, about different anthropologists. Which was really a 2-year project, and it was fascinating. So I left Disappearing World and Granada at that time, with the series having been axed. And then a couple of years later, they brought it back, but not as a proper series. They brought it back to do occasional films. So David Wason took it over and helped run it, and they made various one-off films over a period of the next few years until it sort of basically faded away. Through competition. But it was a shame. It was it lost its momentum, I think, at that time.
So after Strangers Abroad, what did you do then?
I was recruited by the BBC and had an extremely interesting time. It was one of those rather peculiar periods at the BBC. The BBC had The World About Us as its very successful, ongoing, for many years series. And they were looking for somebody to run it. And I was interviewed as a potential head of that series. And I was still finishing Strangers Abroad and had other commitments at the time, but said when I finished I would join the BBC as an executive commissioning other programs rather than as a filmmaker. It was a time I had a family and I was spending too much time traveling and my children small and so on. So I accepted the job, but by the time I went to take up the job, other decisions inside the BBC had come about and they'd axed The World About Us. So I joined the BBC as the commissioning editor of a series that didn't exist. So there was an embarrassment in the BBC and for me, I wasn't quite sure what to do. And they were, I thought, pretty generous. And they said, okay, would you consider, and they gave me two roles. One was, would I represent the BBC on the programmes that were being made by independents in documentaries. So I'd be the commissioner and executive producer on independent productions that the BBC was commissioning. And at the same time, because you were supposed to come and run your own series, we will let you run a series so you can devise a series. So it's a wonderful opportunity, and I created a series called Fine Cut at that time, which were independent feature-length documentaries from around the world, international, from great filmmakers. So I was given a budget, allowed a free hand to commission, and that started while on the one hand I was looking after popular programs like Michael Palin, Pole to Pole, those kinds of programs I had on my books. On the other hand, I was commissioning or buying or co-producing with any filmmaker I wanted to do, because I was very limited structure above me for that from that point of view. And it was a slot on a Saturday night where they weren't expecting high ratings, so I wasn't ratings bound like other commissioners were. And so I was able to commission a very large proportion of those being anthropological films. Not that that was the brief, but I could get them through. So David McDougall, Melissa Llewellyn Davis, Jean Gouche, and so on, I was able to commission and work with them on films. And at the same time work with, that's where I first got to know Werner Herzog, who I've worked with ever since. Fred Wiseman, other great independent filmmakers from around the world. So it was a huge filmic privilege to, I didn't make any of these films, I was the editorial BBC representative and finance part of it, but I worked with them on their films and learned a huge amount and had a fantastic 3 years doing that.
Again, a very difficult question, but you've worked with all these household names in visual anthropology. If you had to select one who you would like to work with again, so to speak, or you really found most interesting to work with, who was it and why?
Well, I have to say Werner Herzog, because I've worked now 15 or 16 films with him ever since. And the first film was a real eye-opener for me, which was a film called Lessons of Darkness, which was a film about the war in Iraq and the oil fires in Iraq at that time. And it was the first time that I had really, because I worked with him on the edit, I observed the edit and discussed it with him while he was editing in Vienna. And it was the first time in terms of concept of film that I could appreciate moving away from a rather important but rigid system where documentary was observational film. You were kind of the all-seeing objective eye, and what you were bringing home and presenting to the public was as close to the truth as you could get it on film. And that was sort of the ambition of most filmmakers of that generation, that era, and what Colin Young taught at the film school and what most filmmakers believed documentary was all about. And here I came across an extraordinary man who was wired differently to everybody else. And he thought of film, what he liked to term the coin, ecstatic truth. His truth was what was in his head and what he was putting across to an audience. And how he put it across was what he would, I think of, or I think of, as an artist, as a creative figure. He wasn't after objective truth, because he felt you could never get that and you can never find that. So he would be quite happy to use imagery in any way possible, as long as a viewer, you understood what he was trying to tell you in his film. And that was quite an extraordinary redirection of my thoughts at that time. I think it's very hard to do that with anthropology, because you'd be doing a disservice to the people you're filming. But in film terms and in film language, it was a very, very important lesson. And so Lessons of Darkness would be the film I would choose from that point of view. Had a huge impact.
I mean, you said it would be very difficult to do that with communities you were filming as an anthropologist, which raises the whole question of anthropological ethics in relation to filmmaking. I mean, it's bad enough being ethical in ordinary fieldwork, but you can disguise your informants and so on and so on. Do you think the problems for an anthropological filmmaker are exacerbated and larger, and what are they?
Yeah, I mean, I think you only have to look at the arguments that have raged ever since with filmmakers like Tim Ash and the Yanomami films, The Feast, and I mean, those. I think that experiment where you showed the films in different forms, and you could see as an audience suddenly how different the material could be depending on how it was edited, how it was presented to you. I think showed the dilemma that anthropologists and filmmakers and the combination of both face, because it is that perennial question of you can never be objective, however hard you work at it. You can never do that, because it depends on circumstance, time, relationships. I mean, 101 factors come into it. So the ethics question is always one about how honest I think you're being to yourself in putting the material across. You have to hope that your style and your method is being correctly interpreted by the people who are viewing it. And that, again, there's that barrier between you as a filmmaker and your audience, because I think Jean Rouch is one of those exceptional characters who claim to make film for the people he is filming in the first place, and himself number two, and his audience was only a sort of a thought after the event. And I think it's an interesting perspective, because you realize that each of those parts of that triangle will look at the same material and through different eyes in any case, and there can never be one single right way of doing it. So I think you have to be, as an anthropologist, you want to do well, and you have to be honorable to the people you're representing. I mean, that's a kind of a duty, I think, more than anything else. But I think most important, you have to be honest to yourself and what you're trying to achieve with your material. And Disappearing World was one of those things where you were trying to balance between a television audience and a strong narrative, which you were creating because it's the narrative that mattered. So you weren't totally being honorable to the people you were filming. I mean, you weren't being dishonorable, but your purpose was not to help them per se. It was to entertain your audience. And so your structure of film always deviated from something that, if you had been an activist, you would have made a different kind of film. Mm. And so that there's always that balancing act going on, I think, in your mind. And I think it's the person who's making the film that has to satisfy themselves that they're doing the right thing. And I think you never 100% reach that conclusion. I've never been happy with what I've presented in any circumstance at all.
People often say that film is very powerful and rich in relation to emotion and a feeling of being there, but it's not terribly good at conveying abstract ideas, whereas writing is the reverse. You can do you see a tension between them, and how do you overcome it?
I don't think film really is a tool for presenting abstract ideas in the same way. It's not you can analyze from film, but film itself isn't an analytical tool in the same way that the pen can be. Mm. I'm just going back to that thing about audience. I'm always in film. I come through a tradition where I'm making film really for either television or the cinema. I'm not making film as an ethnographic tool or as a didactic framework to carry on research after the event. So it's a different form of filmmaking, and there are anthropologists who do that and do it extremely successfully, but they're looking at a different audience and a different use of film. So always for the film I'm doing, I need a strong theme and a good narrative that a non-anthropological audience can understand and grasp. But that's a much simpler framework than if I was doing a text on that people, where I'd need many more references and much more background and much more information. I mean, I think they're just totally separate disciplines.
If you were going to give advice to a young anthropologist who was going into visual media, apart from don't, what advice would you give them? I mean, should they go into mainstream television?
Well, I think one has to know what one is going into it for. That's the problem. I mean, I've been lucky enough to be in different areas of media, in that I've done current affairs and I've done history films and I've done entertainment and I've done Stephen Fry around the world type material. So I've kind of dabbled in a lot of different areas. If I was a purist in terms of anthropology and felt I'm only an anthropological filmmaker, I would have found it almost impossible to survive in the popular media world, because it's deeply competitive. You have to be prepared to be much more general. You have to accept that it's tough and competitive and not an easy world to survive in. And so the label anthropological filmmaker, I was a young anthropologist wanting to be an anthropological filmmaker, I would be quite nervous today, because there's limited scope for that. Whereas if I'm a filmmaker who wants to use anthropological sensitivities in my filmmaking, and where possible working in anthropology, then you know, the world is your oyster. It is competitive, but you have to go into many, many different directions, and you have to be persistent, and you have to be prepared to do subject matter that you may not be at all interested in as part of your stepping stones to do what you are interested in. But I'm very much of the positive, optimistic view in terms of media and film, in that, you know, it's an extraordinary world we're living in, where you know, you can, a disaster happens somewhere in the world and you know it's on film now, whereas 5 years ago you wouldn't. People pull out their phones and they'll film it, or their iPads or whatever. There are outlets on YouTube and the web and all of the different sort of new formats that I had no concept of in the past, which are enable people to have a career, enable people to get material across, and find new forms. So I think it's an exciting time for that, rather than a negative time. I mean, when I talk about it being tough, you just have to think laterally, I think, and find other ways of tackling the material.
Yeah, and another possible excitement is China. I know that you've been doing more and more work in China. Do you think this is a new area for the kind of film you're interested in?
Yeah, undoubtedly. I mean, it's a, you know, I did this film not long ago about concentration camps, and it was shown in cinemas and on television, and I had a lot of international question and answer and discussions that I had to do for different broadcasters and so on around the world. And on one occasion, I was asked if I would do an interview for China, and I hadn't even known the film was being shown in China. But, and a Chinese journalist in London came to interview me in my office, and it was for a Chinese website, and she said it's the biggest website in China, and they're very interested in stories, and they will give them pointers to the film. They're not showing a film on the website, but they're showing stories about films. And so they did a very nice and intelligent interview, and we discussed it, and then we finished, and just before she left, I said, you know, will this be shown very widely? And she said, well, we have an audience of about 500 million. And I suddenly thought, you know, this, we're talking a different world. 500 million people watch their website. Now, that's not all 500 million will watch this particular item, but this is something we don't, doesn't cross your mind normally. And this is about a subject that the Chinese know nothing, really. I mean, it's Holocaust story, 1945, World War II. And you think that suddenly there are vast new audiences, vast new ways of presenting material. And that's fantastic.
Well, I always end, and I think we ought to end in a minute, by saying, is there anything that you'd have liked me to ask you about or talk about, your family, for example, or any part of your life that was really important which I've missed? Otherwise, you can say, no, that's enough, let's have a cup of tea. But
I don't think so. I think the area that I have been the most attracted to now recently, and the area that I find fascinating is probably the opposite end to what I was just talking about in terms of the websites and so on. It is the use of cinema for film. And we kind of talk in today's age as if cinema is dead because the laptop and the iPhone and so on are taking over. Ironically, in terms of I think the kind of documentary that appealed to me, cinema is actually increasing in importance. And I'm now working on a film with also with Werner Herzog about man's relationship with the volcano. And this will be done for a long-form film for big screens on cinema, and an IMAX film for education, 40-minute IMAX film. So where you've got visual material and you've got strong human narrative, there is nothing to compare with the large screen and cinema. Right. So I find it ironic that it sort of late in my career now, I'm moving more in what might be regarded as a Luddite direction of the big screen, whereas the excitement, I think, for a new generation is the opposite direction, which is small, segmentary material on a small screen. But I think as long as those two can coexist, so from my point of view, I think I'm most attracted and most proud of being linked to the cinema documentary, the feature documentary, the long form documentary, than I am to anything else in the past.
I think at that point, thank you very much indeed, Andre. That was fascinating. Yeah. And your first interview after all these interviews.
I dread to think what I've said now.